Hi friends, I am Srikanth from TTWRTC Kama Reddy. I am pursuing my undergraduation in BS stream. So first I would like to thankful to our Honorable Secretary Sir providing a wonderful opportunity to every students to improve their communication skills. So my subject is political science. My topic is, it's a very important topic in concept in Indian Constitution. And the fundamental rights, that is the top, my topic is the fundamental rights. My topic is fundamental rights. So before going to start my session, I have a question for you all. The question is, what is mean of fundamental rights? The fundamental rights means a basic human rights. Means the fundamental rights are provide the basics to every individuals and citizens to survive in the society. Without fundamental rights, the no citizen shall be survive in the society. The fundamental rights protect every citizen from the arbitrary and absolute power of state. So these fundamental rights are applied to all the citizens, irrespective of class, caste, gender, religion, and place of birth. So why do we need these fundamental rights? We need fundamental rights for the fundamental rights enlightening every citizens towards the personality development of every citizen. The fundamental rights are play a significant role in our national development, because the fundamental rights are promoting a individual development lead to a community development. A community development leads to a national development. So the fundamental rights are playing a significant role in our national development. So let us go to discuss where is the first genesis of fundamental rights. The fundamental rights are first appeared in the book, the Magna Carta, is also known as the Great Charter of the Liberties. It's an agreement between King John of England and the people on 15 June 1215. So with that agreement, the England Kingdom is providing the few rights to every citizen of England. So next is the fundamental rights in America, known as the Bill of Rights. It was adopted on 25 September 1789. The Bill of Rights are guarantees of personal freedom to every citizen of America. And you are very familiar with the UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It was adopted on 10 December 1948 by United Nations General Assembly. It provides the essential human rights throughout the world. So these are the basis for the fundamental rights. So now let us go to discuss the fundamental rights in India. So before that, so what are the basis towards the incorporation of fundamental rights into Indian Constitution? These are in 1928, Nehru Report, which Motilal Nehru Report, and in 1931, International Congress Karachi Session. In 1928, Motilal Nehru arrived at the concept of fundamental rights. That report is called as Nehru Report. In International Congress Karachi Session in 1931, our national fighters, national leaders, they are discussing about the top concept, the fundamental rights. So Nehru Report and International Congress Karachi Session, the basis towards the incorporation of fundamental rights into Indian Constitution. So Indian fundamental rights are taken from the inspiration of USA Constitution, the Bill of Rights. These fundamental rights are incorporated into Part 3 of Indian Constitution from the Article 12 to 35. That's why the Part 3 of Indian Constitution, it is also known as the Magna Carta of Indian Constitution. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Iron Man of India, acted as the chairman of Fundamental Rights Committee. And J.B. Kripalani acted as the chairman of the Fundamental Rights Subcommittee. So before the discussing about the fundamental rights, we need to discuss about the Article 12 and Article 13. So what is Article 12? What is Article 13? So Article 12 is giving the definition of state. Means, according to the Article 12, what should be consist in a state? According to Article 12, state should be consist central government and parliament, state government and state legislature, and all local authorities like municipalities and panchayat rajs. You can see in the picture also this parliament and state legislature and panchayats. So next article is Article 13. Article 13 states that if any laws inconsistent with fundamental rights, means the state legislatures, they are preparing any laws for the against the fundamental rights, that laws invalid, the laws are not exist in society according to Article 13. So Article 13 is protecting the all the fundamental rights. So let us go to discuss what are the fundamental rights. Originally in Indian Constitution we have seven fundamental rights. These are right to equality, right to freedom, right to against exploitation, and right to religion, right to constitutional remedies, and right to property. But now we have only six fundamental rights. The sixth fundamental right, right to property, it's deleted from the fundamental rights by the 44th Amendment Act 1978. And this right is incorporated into as a legal right under 300A article. So we have only six fundamental rights. So let us go to discuss what are the fundamental rights. So first fundamental right is right to equality. Friends, you know that before the Britishers, Indian society practiced huge inequality by different unequal activities like untouchable activities, gender discriminatory activities, and religious discriminatory activities. For the eradication of these inequalities, our constitutional framers adopted this right to equality in fundamental rights. With the untouchability in society, could we make a society equal? We could not be make a society equal. And the equality is the base of democracy. Without equality in society, we could not make democracy successful, because of the democracy means by the people, of the people, and for the people. So the equality is the concept is very important in the Indian society, because of the Indian society following the democracy. So let us, the right to equality explains by four articles from Article 14 to 18. So let us go to discuss what are the articles. So Article 14 guarantees that all are equal before law and equal protection before law. So both concepts are very similar, but both concepts have the different meaning. First, we have to take the concept all are equal before law. This concept taken from the inspiration of Britain Constitution. The all are equal before law means every citizen shall be subjugated with same laws, same courts, and same procedure. If we take example traffic rules, if Prime Minister violate traffic rules and at the same time a common man violate the traffic rules, they both will prosecute by same court. If Prime Minister prosecute by Supreme Court of India, a common man also prosecute by Supreme Court of India. There is no different court for Prime Minister and his common man. With that article, the Prime Minister, PM to CM equal. Here CM means common man. So Prime Minister to common man, all are equal with the Article 14. And the second concept is the equal protection before law. This concept was taken inspiration of American Constitution. According to this concept, every citizen have the freedom to the equal treatment in equal circumstances. Means the state should not show any discrimination based on wealth and status of person, according to the Article 14. So now let us go to Article 15. Article 15 is prohibiting the discrimination on the grounds of religion, race, caste, gender, and place of birth. And Article 15 is also stating that state shall not subject any citizens to restriction and conditions to access public places like wells and public worship places and public entertainment malls and public shops. In that Article 15, we have few exceptions. With articles, we have the few exception. The Article 15.3, with this Article 15.3, the state shall permitted to make any special provision to women and children. The state can permitted to make any special provision to women and children for the upliftment. In the part of our state, our government providing 30% to reservation to the women, according to the Article 15.3. Next, Article 15.4 states that state shall provide the reservation to social and economically backward classes. By the this is the exception to the Article 15. Let us go to discuss a current issue. You are all are very familiar with that issue. This is Sabarimala issue case. Yes, Sabarimala is a temple, the conflict between tradition and women's rights. As per tradition of tradition and customs, women between 10 to 50 years of age were not allowed to enter into the Sabarimala temple. Just now we discussed, according to the Article 14, all are equal before law. According to the Article 15, there is no discrimination on the grounds of gender. So with that case, in Sabarimala temple, the discrimination going on. With this aspect, the restrictions, women between 10 to 50 years old, they are not allowed to the temple. So for that, the few women rights activists approached the Supreme Court. On September 28, 2018, Supreme Court had given verdict that the everyone have the right to entry into the temple. So this is a Sabarimala case, means the fundamental rights are justiciable. We can amend the fundamental rights and we can protect the fundamental rights. We are seen in this article. Next, we are moving to the next article, Article 16. Article 16 provides equal opportunities for all citizens in public employment. Means state should not discriminate any individuals on the grounds of caste, gender, religion. So for that, the Article 16 provides equal opportunities for all citizens. But you might be get a one question. This is the reservation. The reservation providing the backward classes for the upliftment of that backward classes only. We didn't consider as the discrimination. Recently, our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi introduced economically backward classes bill in Parliament through 124th Amendment Act 2019. With this bill, the state providing the 10% reservation to economically backward classes. Because these 124th Amendment Act 2019 came into force by the amending the Article 16. Next, we are moving to the Article 17. Article 17 is prohibiting the untouchability. The Article 17 is prohibiting the untouchability. Friends, you know that if you look back into our history, the huge untouchability activities practiced in Indian society. For the eradication of these social evil, Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar, Mahatma Jyotiba Phule, the social reformers, fought several decades and several centuries for the eradication of this untouchability. Friends, with the untouchability in society, could we make society equal? We could not make society equal with the untouchability. For that, our constitutional framers are provided this article in the fundamental rights by the right to equality. So, before the base of Article 17, prohibition of untouchability is the Untouchability Offence Act 1955, renamed as the Protection of Civil Right in 1976. According to the Protection of Civil Right Act 1955 in 1976, if anyone commit to untouchable activities, they will be imprisoned up to 6 months, and they are fined up to 2,500, and they are disqualified to participate in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha elections. With the Article 17, means Article 17 is eradicating the untouchability in the Indian society. Well, the next article is the abolishing of title. Why the state abolishing the titles? During the Britishers periods, the Britishers are conferred the many titles for few class peoples like Jamindars, Raj Bahadurs. When the Britishers conferred that titles, the peoples are shown their supremacy on common peoples. They harassed common peoples. For that, with this issue, could we make our society equal? We could not be make our society equal. For that, our constitutional framers provide Article 18 to abolishing the titles. However, our government is giving the rights, the awards to every citizens like Bharat Ratna, Padma Vibhushan and Vibhushan for their outstanding performance. In the abolition of title, we have the few clauses. These are the 18(1). It's prohibiting the state from conferring any titles. Means the state should not confer any title to any citizen. According to Article 18(2), it prohibits a citizen of India accepting any title from any foreign state without consent president. The citizen of India should not accept any titles the conferring from the foreign state without consent president. The Article 18(3) stating that a citizen or a foreigner holding any office of profit under the state cannot accept any title from the foreigner without consent president by Article 18(3). So here we have the one case is the Balaji Raghavan versus Union of India. In this case, the Supreme Court had given verdict. If any awardee, they should not use their awards, the prefix and suffix of the name of the awardee. If they are used the prefix and suffix, it leads to inequality. Means they are showing I'm great, you are not great, like that. For that, the in Balaji Raghavan case versus Union of India, the Supreme Court had given the about the Article 18. So next we are moving to the next right, right to freedom. Friend, you know that the freedom was a key aspect in Indian national movement. Our independence freedom fighters are fought several decades towards against the Britishers for the freedom. Without freedom to citizen, how can we develop? For that, this right to provided to all the citizen of India. So right to freedom, it consists of the four articles from the Article 19 to 22. Let us go to discuss in detail. Article 19 provides 6 freedoms to every citizen of India. Article 19 provides 6 freedom to every citizen of India. These are the 19A, providing freedom of speech and expression to the every citizen. We have the right to express our thoughts openly by the Article 19A. Next, 19B, freedom to assemble peaceably and without arms. The 19B, the providing freedom to assemble peaceably and without arms. A few months back, the many political parties assembled for their campaigning because of they have that right according to the 19B, freedom to assemble peaceably and without arms. So next we are moving to the Article 19C, the freedom to form association or unions. We are seeing now the many labor unions, student unions, for the representation to the higher authorities. That's why they are forming their unions according to the Article 19C. Next article is 19D. 19D is freedom to move throughout India. If I am from Telangana, I can move to the Maharashtra, I can move to Rajasthan because I have the right to move everywhere of India according to the Article 19D. The next article is 19E, the freedom to settle in any part of India. According to the 19E, the every citizen have the right to settle any part of India. I am from the South India, I can settle in North India, if Rajasthan, Maharashtra, if my wish. So according to the 19E. Next article is 19F, freedom to practice any profession. According to 19F, the freedom to practice any profession. If I like barbering profession, I can practice that profession. If I like the goldsmith profession, I can practice that profession, according to the Article 19F. Next, we are moving to the Article 20. The Article 20 protecting in respect of conviction for offence. Article 20 protecting every citizen in respect of conviction for offence. According to the Article 20, no person shall be penalized unless is disobey law. No person shall be penalized unless is disobey law. Means the Article 20 protect convicts from the arbitrary and excessive punishment by its provisions. Let us discuss what are the provisions of Article 20. In Article 20, we have three provisions. The first provision is the ex post facto law. It means no person shall be subjugated to any penalty greater than the prescribed by the law. The how much penalty the prescribed by the law, that much how to pay. So next the article is next is the no double jeopardy. Means no person shall be punished for the same offence more than once. If I commits for any offence, I shall the prosecute and punish by only one time according to the law. Next is no self-incrimination. No self-incrimination means no person shall be forced to give any evidence against the himself. According to the self-incrimination, no person shall be forced to give evidence against the himself. Now we are moving to the Article 21. The Article 21 is protecting every citizen's life and liberty. Means Article 21 declares that no citizen shall be deprived of his life and personal liberty except according to the procedure establishment by law. In Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India case, the Supreme Court declared the few rights under the Article 21. Under these rights are the right to livelihood, right to privacy, right to shelter, right to health, right to information. These rights are very important to the every citizens. The protect from the state absolute power. Next, we have the Article 21A. Article 21A states that right to education. It means the state should provide free and compulsory education to all the citizens of children of age 6 to 14. We take the Anganwadi institutions. The Anganwadi institutions maintaining a part of Article 21A. In that institution, they are providing education and nutritious food to all the children who are age of 6 years. This provision was, the right to education provision was added by the 86th Constitutional Amendment Act 2002. This Amendment Act is a major milestone to country to achieve education for all. The government described this step, the second resolution, in the chapter of citizens' right. You can see here a picture of the 6 to the 14 years children. Next, we are moving to the Article 22. Article 22 protects every citizens against arrest and detentions. So what is the meaning of detention? Detention means if state feel any person threaten to law and order, they will be detained according to the law because of they are threatening to the law and order. So by the Article 22, the protecting every citizens from the arrest and detention by the following provisions. So let us discuss what are that provisions. In that provision, first provision is 22A. 22A is stating that right to inform of the grounds of arrest. 22A is right to inform of the grounds of the arrest. Means why they are arresting, we have to notice him, the why he is arresting by us. So it protects the every citizens from the arrest and the detention. And next provision is 22B, right to defend himself by a lawyer. The every citizen have the right to defend himself by a lawyer in any supreme judiciary bodies. The next provision is the 22C, right to be produced an accused person before magistrate within 24 hours. According to the 22C, the right to be produced an accused person before the magistrate within 24 hours. So with these articles from 19 to 22, the right to freedom, protecting the all the citizens' freedoms by its articles from 19 to 22. Next, we are moving to the next right, that is right against exploitation. What is the need of this right? So what is the need of this right? If you take in our Indian society, there are millions of people in underprivileged. These peoples are affecting by the different exploitation. If you take human trafficking, the forced labor and child labors, because of they have no awareness for the protection of these common mans. For that, our constitutional framers, they established this right against exploitation. It consists of two articles, Article 23 and Article 24. Article 23 stating that prohibition of human trafficking and forced labor. At the same time, the Article 24 stating that prohibition of child labors. So let us go to discuss the briefly about these articles. Before that, you can see the how the exploitation going on in our country by the picture here, first picture. So now we are moving to the Article 23. Article 23 prohibiting human trafficking and forced labor. What is mean of human trafficking? Human trafficking means selling and buying of human beings. The selling and buying of human beings called as human trafficking. If you say, and use them as slave and different inhuman activities like prostitutionary activities and devadasi activities. For the next, what is mean of forced labor? The forced labor means the work without remuneration. The forced labor means work without remuneration called as the forced labor. If you see like the begging and bonded labor. For the protection of every citizens from these evils, human trafficking and forced labor, the Article 23 is established. Means Article 23 is protecting a common man from the exploitation like human trafficking and forced labor. Next, we are moving to Article 24. The Article 24 prohibiting the child labor. So who are called as child labor? The child laborers means who are the children below the 14 years age. They are working in a majority of places like industries and factories. They are called as child laborers. You can see the two pics here, the of child laborers. First pic and second pic. In 2006, the government of India banned the employment of children as a domestic servants. Work like the work in hotels, resorts, dhabas and factories. And here we are taking one case is MC Mehta versus Tamil Nadu government. In that case, the Supreme Court had given verdict that the below the age of 14 year children does not work in hazardous factories and crackers industries. If anyone commits this activity, they will be punished according to the law. So moving before the another articles, another right, we have to discuss the Article 23 and 24 briefly. That Article 23 and 24 playing very key role to prohibiting the exploitations. Means it protecting the every citizens, every common man. It is not only the state responsibility. It is the responsibility of every citizen of India to protect the children's and common man's. So you have to protect, you have the responsibility to protect the child's and the common man's from these exploitations. Next, we are moving to the next right, right to religion. Right to freedom of religion. So in our country, there are many religions. Hindu, Christian, Muslims, and Buddhist. The many religions are there. For the protection of all the religions, our state is the secular state. Protecting the every religion by the secularism. You know, dear friend, what is the base of this right? The base of this right is the preamble of India. The preamble of India stating that we are the people of India, the constitute Indian constitution into sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic and republic. Means you can observe the word secular. The secular means the all the religions are equal. In our country, the different religions are there. The different religions are getting the equal importance in our country because of our country is a secular country. So this right to freedom of religion explained by four articles from the article 25 to 28. So let us discuss about the article, about the articles from the 25 to 28. So article 25, that provides the freedom to every citizens to conscience, profess, practice and propagate of religion. Means it's providing the freedom to conscience, means inner freedom of an individual to mold his relation with God. And freedom to profess, it declaring that every individual has the right to express his religious beliefs and the faith openly and freely. The freedom to practice means that every citizens can perform of his religious worships, rituals, ceremonies and exhibition. And last one is freedom to propagate. The every individual have the right to propagate his religious freely, but don't force anyone to the conversation of another religion. I'm Srikant, I'm from the Hindu. If I like the Buddhism, I have the right to convert it to the Buddhism by the article the 25. You can see your pic, the showing the article 15 about the freedom of conscience, profess and practice and propagation in the first pic. Yes. So now we are moving to the next article, article 26. Article 26 providing the freedom to manage religious affairs. Here article 25 guarantees rights of individual. At the same time, article 26 guarantees rights of religious section. Means under the article 26, it consists of four provisions. With that provisions, it's giving the freedom to every religious section. Let us go to discuss what are that provisions. These are, the first provision is 26A. 26A is providing right to every citizen to establish and maintain the institution for religious and charitable purpose. Article 26A providing the right to every citizen to manage any religious and charitable institutions. Next, the provision article 26B. 26B providing that right to manage its own affairs in the matter of the religions. Rights to manage its own affairs in matter of right to religion. 26C, they're providing that right to own and acquire movable and immovable properties. At the same time, article 26D is right to administer such properties, movable and immovable properties in accordance with law. These properties can be administered accordance to with law. With Article 26. So here Article 25 providing the rights to individuals. At the same time, Article 26 providing the guarantees rights of a religious section. So next we are moving to the next article, Article 27. Article 27 is prohibiting of collection of taxes. The Article 27 is prohibiting the collection of taxes for the promotion of any particular religion by the state. Means state should not impose any taxes on the people for the promotion of any particular religion, according to the Article 27. Next, Article 28. The Article 28 stating that no religious instructions shall be provided in any educational institutions maintained by state. If we take example, the Gurukulams are totally maintained by the state funds. So according to the Article 28, there shall not be provide the religious instructions in Gurukulams, because the Gurukulam educational institutions are maintaining by the state funds. But Article 28 is exempted to religious trust and institutions. So Article 28, it's exempted to the religious trust. This is relevant to the Article 28. Next, we are moving to the, before the moving to the another right, these are the articles, so the freedom of religion articles, the providing the freedom to every religion to profess, practice their belief and faith openly. So it is very important in our society, because of our society existing with a huge unity and diversity. Means in our society consists a different religions, the many religions. So it is very important in Indian society. The next right is the cultural and educational right. Friends, you know that India is the treasury of rich culture and heritage. That's why this right is established. So what is the use of this right? Because these rights are protecting the minorities from the majority for their wish like education and culture. Because in our country, existing with huge unity and diversity, in this huge unity and diversity, the protection of minorities, culture and the education from the majority is very important. If we not provide this right, if there may be chances to use the majority supremacy on minorities. So who are called as minorities? In our country, the many minorities groups are like the Muslims, Sikhs, Jains. They are the minorities communities in our country. The many more are there, but I am only telling about these communities. So this right explains by the two articles, from the Article 29 to 30. So let us go to discuss the what is Article 29, what is Article 30. Article 29 is protecting the interest of minorities, whether it is educational interest or cultural interest. In the Article 29, we have the two provisions, that these are the Article 29.1. It's providing that any section of citizens residing any part of the country having distinct culture, script and language, they have the right to conserve themselves, their culture and language and script, according to the Article 29.1. The next article is Article 29.2. The 29.2 is stating that no citizen shall not be denied the admission into any educational institutions maintained by the state. If educational institution maintained by the state on the base of the language and the culture, we should not deny any citizen to give the admission according to the Article 29.2. If anyone violated these articles, they will be punished accordance with law. So next we have the right is Article 30 is protecting the rights of minorities. The Article 30 is protecting the rights of minorities to establish and administrate educational institutions. Under the Article 30 consists of few more provisions. These are Article 30A empowers the minorities to establish and administrate any educational institutions. If we take Aligarh Muslim University, it's a minority educational institution. This educational institution is established and administered by that minorities. Next, the article is Article 30B. Article 30B stating that the compensation amount for the acquisition of property to minorities means if the 2 acres or 3 acres lands of minorities are located in Hyderabad, if any purpose the state is acquisited thus property, the state should be give the compensation to that minority group according to the Article 30B. And the next one is Article 30C. It's stating that the state should not show discriminate to grant any funds and aid to the minority welfare schools. If we take the schools, the minority welfare schools, and that schools, the state should not show any discriminate to grant funds and aid according to the Article 30C. So next, we are moving to the right to property. Before the moving to this right, where the give the brief about the article, the right to freedom of religion. So right to freedom of religion is very important. At the same time with them, the cultural and educational right also very important. This cultural and educational right, the protect the interest of the minorities to provide the education to the minorities and protect the culture of minorities. So now we are moving to the next right. Right to property. The right to property was deleted from the fundamental rights list through 44th Amendment Act in 1978 and it is added into the legal rights under Article 300A. So there is no need to discuss about this right. So now we are moving to the last right, right to constitutional remedies, the 32. Without hurt to a person, hurt to a man, he could not be slave. It is like that, without this right to constitutional remedies, the right, fundamental rights are meaningless. It can't survive. The Article 32 is acting as the soul of the fundamental rights. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar has conferred Article 32 as soul of Indian Constitution. Why he described this article as soul of Indian Constitution? Because of if any fundamental rights of citizens were violated by state or other citizens, that citizen can be file a case against the violators, like state and the person, in the supreme judiciary bodies, Supreme Court and High Court. Supreme Court and High Court. If you file a case on the Supreme Judiciary bodies, the High Court and Supreme Courts release writs on the state and the violators for the protection of his rights. That writs like the habeas corpus, mandamus, the prohibition, and certiorari and quo warranto. These are the writs providing the every citizen to protect their fundamental rights for themselves by approaching Supreme Court and High Court judiciary bodies. So eventually I am concluding my topic. The enforcement of fundamental rights is very important. Without enforcement of fundamental rights, we could not make our democracy success. And the fundamental rights are playing a significant role in our national development. Because of the fundamental rights are promoting individual development. Means If the fundamental rights are promoting individual development, it leads to a community development. When the individual development leads to a community development, the community development leads to our national development. So like that, the fundamental rights are very important to the every citizen of our country. We should be aware about our fundamental rights, then only we can get the fruits of state. So thank you to all the lecturers who are supported me, and thank you to our honorable Praveen Kumar sir providing the wonderful opportunity to expose myself. Thank you, sir.